So now I have the distinct pleasure to introduce the moderator of our last panel of the day. This is Jeffrey Anslus, the Assistant Professor of International Mental Health and Trauma in the Division of Interdisciplinary Inquiry at Lesley University.
Well, thank you. This has been a stimulating morning. That was a phenomenal presentation, David. Thank you for that. Next up, we're going to be hearing from Deborah, who's going to be speaking on EMDR and Buddhist practice. I guess I can tell you a little bit more about Deborah. Deborah is a clinical psychologist who trains and consults widely on psychological trauma therapy and relationship to contemplative practice. She's on the faculty of the Institute of Meditation and Psychotherapy and the co-director of the Jewel Heart Buddhist Chaplaincy Program. And I'll invite Deborah to begin.
Okay. So this is a presentation on EMDR and Buddhist practice. Okay, EMDR is a comprehensive PTSD treatment that addresses both symptom management and reduction, and remission and resolution. EMDR has been validated by much outcome research as a highly effective and gold standard trauma treatment, comparable in efficacy to prolonged exposure therapy. EMDR engages the client in multimodal process, including cognitive, emotional, somatic, and relational elements. It's integrative. One can easily embed almost any other therapy model or technique within it. In this sense, EMDR is a meta-therapy, a flexible treatment framework. EMDR is also client-centered. The client, rather than the therapist, directs the trajectory of the trauma processing, while the therapist serves as the guide. EMDR is optimistic. There's a well-known natural capacity to heal from trauma, as shown by the fact that many people, in fact, do recover spontaneously from single-incident traumatic experiences, and they don't get stuck in PTSD. EMDR assumes this natural capacity is still present somehow, but that it's somehow been blocked, and works to leverage and jumpstart that process for any level of PTSD, simple to complex. This is critical, and we will return to this point. So EMDR is a secular trauma therapy, yes? Not designed or intended to be explicitly contemplative, but it does have meditative characteristics, unusual in Western psychotherapy. EMDR's core trauma processing is mostly a silent interior exploration and reflection by the client, with minimal therapist intervention, and the use of eye movements. Rhythmic bilateral stimulation suggests the relaxation response, a well-known secular meditation paradigm, as well as certain Buddhist visualization and recitation practices, which are said to enhance meditation. Nevertheless, EMDR contains no formal meditation. Unlike the heightened concentration cultivated by MBSR and other MBIs, EMDR requires only normal levels of attention, although this is enhanced relative to the impaired attention of PTSD. Nor does EMDR appeal explicitly to spiritual or transcendental concepts. So in that sense, can we say EMDR is implicitly contemplative? We answer the question using the functional, asymmetrical, functional analogy that about trauma and Buddhism that David just presented to us. This model shows in general the trauma, how trauma relates to Buddhism. In this talk, I focus on EMDR therapy, specifically correlating it with Buddhist practice, which should shed significant light on EMDR's mechanisms of action. In particular, I propose that just as Buddhist practice operates by experiential insight into our everyday misapprehension of reality, analogously, in the psychological realm, EMDR fosters experiential insight into the misapprehension that the trauma is still present and dangerous. Both thereby heal their respective levels of suffering, traumatic suffering for EMDR, and all suffering for Buddhism. Now let's compare EMDR and Buddhist practice to show how EMDR is implicitly contemplative. For an overview of both EMDR and Buddhist practice and how they line up according to the asymmetrical functional analogy, EMDR follows the consensus phase model of trauma treatment that goes back to Pierre Janet, as David said. In phase one, the clients learn skills for managing traumatic symptoms, especially safety, confidence, and stable attention, sufficient to support phase two trauma processing. Analogously, Mahayana refuge practice and attention training together correspond to EMDR's phase one, and they support insight meditation, which corresponds to EMDR's phase two. That's almost all I'm going to be able to say about phase one in this talk, from here on, it'll be mostly phase two about actual trauma processing as it relates to Buddhist insight meditation. Here's an overview of phase two. Rather than the official description of EMDR's eight-step protocol, I'll show you the actual sequence of steps that happen in therapy. First, the client invokes the phase one skills and states to prepare for trauma processing. They begin actual trauma processing by invoking the traumatic material as a memory, a trigger, or a feared future event. Then the client identifies their positive potential as an explicit belief such as, I am worthy, no matter how weak that may be at this early point. The positive belief is then left in the background for now and not yet explicitly processed. That comes later. And yet, it sets an implicit positive trajectory. Then the client rates their overall distress on a scale 0 to 10, 10 being the worst, which the therapist will use to track progress during actual trauma processing. The distress level is typically high in the beginning, reflecting the active PTSD symptoms. Then we begin the actual trauma processing. Let's look at how this works. It's a sequence of sets of silent free association, each 60 seconds or sometimes longer, accompanied by bilateral stimulation. For those of you who don't know it, it looks like this. Okay. Or other kinds of bilateral stimulation are used as well. Other somatic systems can be introduced. After each set of free association, the therapist asks, what do you get now? And assesses whether there is movement in progress or in its place, blockage, stalling, cycling, or a spike in traumatic symptoms. Most often there is progress, and the therapist just says, go with that to start another set. But if needed, the therapist offers a targeted intervention, which we call an interweave, to modulate traumatic symptoms, unblock processing, or break a negative cycle. The therapist is always observing the client's somatic state and occasionally asks the client for a current distress rating. The sequence of sets continue over sessions until the distress level is 0 or 1. Sometimes that happens gradually and sometimes in dramatic breakthroughs, as we shall see in a case snippet. So how does EMDR's free association actually work? The client starts with a multimodal image of the traumatic target, including emotions, beliefs, body sensations. Then they move among linked personal memories and experiences, traumatic and non-traumatic, past, present, and future, sometimes fixing attention on meaningful content. It is here that EMDR activates the client's natural capacity to heal from trauma. The free association process, empowered by phase one, driven by the client's associations, catalyzed by bilateral stimulation and the positive belief, assisted by the targeted interventions, enables the client to integrate the actual traumatic material into the web of personal memory and experience. and thereby generate insight into the trauma memory's true nature, that the memory is just a memory among many memories, and dissolves the traumatic distress. Though there is initial contact with the traumatic material in free association, EMDR processing is very unlike prolonged exposure, where the client remains focused continuously on that material. Here's an example of transformative insight in EMDR therapy. Tina had PTSD from witnessing the death of a closest friend in an auto accident, holding her as she died. The memory was deeply disturbing and had been generating severe traumatic reactions for years. Here, the crucial moment in Tina's trauma processing session. I say, put all the pieces together, Tina. The image of you holding her, the negative belief it's my fault, the desperation, the agony, those sensations in your eyes, your heart, hands, and arms. She processes silently with BLS. She then says, it's weird, amazing, my body. It feels gently rocked, peaceful, restful. She was gasping for air. I held her close. She processes again. Oh my, I just remembered something. I forgot all these years. I touched my hand to her cheek. I kissed her forehead. I told her I loved her. She processes more. Even though the picture's in my head, it's not disturbing. No chills. I'm outside it for the first time in my life. Not in it. Stepped back, like a movie. Could see me holding her. And I say, how disturbing is this to you right now? She says, the distress is almost gone. I'm watching it. It was a terrible incident. I picture it. It wasn't my fault. Then she looked at me and said, good. Tina achieved a sudden and profound disidentification from that moment of traumatic experience. That session actually ended her intrusive re-experiencing symptoms. She still had more work to do, but this was her crucial breakthrough. Such breakthroughs are common in EMDR. This was clearly a decisive insight experience, transforming cognition, emotions, body experience, analogous to, but in a very different level from decisive insight and transformation that Buddhists seek on the way to enlightenment. Now, Buddhist practice. According to contemporary mindfulness or the Vipassana tradition, EMDR's free association might seem like the antithesis of meditation, unrestrained distraction, engaging objects of attention rather than letting them go. But for those familiar with the Mahayana practice of analytical meditation, which is a combination of moving and fixed attention, EMDR's free association might in fact ring a bell, but at the level of ordinary rather than enhanced concentration. In analytical meditation, one assesses a topic from multiple standpoints. When during this moving attention process, an intuition or a hint of realization arises on a point, the meditator focuses there to strengthen the non-conceptual understanding and gain insights. I propose that the analytical meditation process is a Buddhist functional analog to EMDR's free association. I underscore that analytical meditation, though, is a form of insight meditation. It is simply not thinking about something in an intellectual, top-down sort of way. The point is to gain a felt and vivid knowing from one's depths via both small and large aha moments, including emotional and somatic knowing as well as cognitive. Comparing and contrasting EMDR's free association and Mahayana analytical meditation is beyond the scope of this talk. But here's a somewhat whimsical but useful account that summarizes it. Here's a meditator and an EMDR client receiving bilateral stimulation. Both begin by bringing up the thing they want to dissolve. Tibetans call this the object of negation. For the meditator, that's the misapprehended, inherently existent nature of self, symbolized here by the rocks. It's very subtle, so making it a conscious process is not easy. Likewise, the trauma sufferer activates their traumatized state, but without becoming overwhelmed by traumatic reaction. When we call, we can call this, the traumatic nature of memory, the psychological object of negation. A big asymmetry here, of course, is that in trauma, the object of negation is not the least bit subtle and all too easy to invoke. In both cases, the object of negation is, in Mahayana terms, the mistaken inherent existence, the solid, encapsulated, permanent nature, unable to change or interact with other content. That's what makes it an ongoing source of suffering. Next, both sides elicit opposing and integrative content that help to dissolve the object of negation, undercutting mistaken thoughts and perceptions about self, relationship, world, using the power of attention, heightened relative to each realm, to undermine the perceived inherent existence that blocks integration. The meditator might use logic, internal inquiry, visualization, compassion, and so on, including images of enlightenment as future ideal. These are universal content and themes. Analogously, the EMDR client brings up personal material, like autobiographical memory, pleasant thoughts, forgotten details of trauma, and so on, and with the positive belief as a personal future ideal. Using the respective level of concentration, both sides examine the content using analytical meditation or EMDR-free association. Eventually, there's a breakthrough. The object of negation naturally dissolves, and transconceptual insight, large and small, arises, a leap toward enlightenment or healing. For the meditator, this might be the insight into interdependence. For the PTSD sufferer, the traumatized state might weaken or even dissolve, ultimately leaving the traumatic event as just one memory among others. When the client has processed the traumatic material, reduced their level of distress, and ended re-experiencing, one might assume that the healing work is complete. But there are emotional and somatic residues from having been stuck in a cycle of re-experiencing and avoidance for such a long time. EMDR has thus two more steps to address these residual traumatic effects. First, the client brings forward the positive belief, the one that had been left behind, kind of in the background. That was in the background during the trauma processing up to this point. And explicitly, here we explicitly process that from weak to strong, using the same method of sets of free association with bilateral stimulation. Then they similarly process any remaining body discomfort. Though there's still not time here to explain in more detail how this works, what we can say, or what we surmise, is that this is functionally analogous, including, in fact, in the same sequence of the purification of mind, emotions, and body in Vajrayana practice, the esoteric branch of Tibetan Vajrayana. And so I'm going to conclude with a case example, again with Tina, regarding the processing of her positive belief, removing the lingering emotional distress. Her re-experiencing and distress symptoms are now at this point at below clinical levels. We turn to the remaining emotional issues, particularly her self-deprecation, by strengthening the positive belief, which has been in the background so far. I say, as you think about the image you started with, the moment your friend died, is the term or belief, "I'm worthy," still the thought you prefer about yourself? Tina says, "I want to change it, I think, to I'm a loving person." I say, "Good. On the scale from 1 to 7, how true is that thought?" She says, "I think a 5. I say, "What gets in the way of it being a 6 or a 7, 7 being the strongest? She says, I don't know if she heard me, felt my kiss. Maybe I was too late. I say, go with that. She processes this silently. She then says, with tears running down her face, oh, I see. It doesn't work that way. It's about the love. I gave her what she needed the most. I told her I loved her. I am a loving person. I say very gently, yes. So on that scale of 1 to 7, how true is that thought to you now? She says, looking straight at me, a 7. I couldn't save her, but I did love her. I do love her.
Thank you, Deborah. We're going to save our questions until all of the panelists have been able to speak, and actually we'll have a break and then come back and do the questions. So our next panelist is Dr. Barbara Phillips, who is a clinical social worker with expertise in the treatment of adults who carry the legacy of childhood trauma. She's also a past president of the New England Society for Treatment of Trauma and Dissociation and a current dissertation chair for the PsyD program at JFK University College of Graduate and Professional Studies. So if you could welcome Dr. Phillips.
Hi. I'm so happy to be here today in this lovely, energetic field, and also to talk about, as my friends and colleagues would know, one of my very favorite subjects to talk about, sensory motor psychotherapy. So the name of the talk today is a sensory motor psychotherapy approach for the treatment of trauma, embodying the foundational principles. Sensory motor psychotherapy is a body-mind talk therapy for the treatment of trauma. Sensory motor psychotherapy may be considered implicitly contemplative in that it is inspired by a range of Buddhist teachings and practices specific to the foundational principles upon which it is based. As one learns to be guided by the principles, moreover, as one learns to embody the principles, the techniques follow thereafter. In today's talk, I will bring to light the inherently contemplative underpinnings of the sensory motor approach, as guided by the principles in general, and what it means for us as therapists to embody the principles in particular. The principles. The principles guide the internal organization of a sensory motor psychotherapist, and they dictate the quality of interaction with our clients. The principles inform an emotional attitude and a consciousness that are felt by the deeper parts of the other, and therefore, in turn, earn the cooperation of the unconscious. The principles form an emotional attitude and a consciousness that are felt by the deeper parts of the other, and therefore, in turn, earn the cooperation of the unconscious. To embody the principles in one's treatment approach is to act continuously from this unconscious base. One of my sources of inspiration for my talk today is Ron Kurtz, the late Ron Kurtz, who was founder of the Hakomi method, a psychotherapy method informed by Buddhist and Taoist teachings to which sensory motor psychotherapy owes its origins. In Ron's words, it's more important to understand and embrace the principles than it is to learn techniques. It's more important to have a feel of the work than to have the theory. Actually, we need both. But the emotional attitude of the therapist is of utmost importance. Both clinically useful and profoundly significant, the following are the set of principles that guide the practice of sensory motor psychotherapy. Unity, organicity, nonviolence, body-mind holism, and mindfulness. The principles are simple However, nonviolence on our terms, and even mindfulness also on our terms, are not necessarily the immediate concern of all practitioners. The first principle I'll talk about is unity. Do you know what this is? This is called murmurings, murmurings of starlings, and they swarm in unity and all making all kinds of patterns. My first choice was to have a little video of it, but I had to settle on it on a still photo. The primary and most destructive illusion is the false distinction between self and other. We see each other as separate objects because we've learned to think of ourselves and others in this way, and also because we see through the eyes. The East has always known the senses lie. In the words of Ron Kurtz, the unencumbered heart sees differently. And as Dan Siegel is wont to say, eyesight is not mind sight. The principle of unity speaks to interconnectedness and intraconnectedness. Yes, we're actually in this together, despite that we've been taught we're all alone. The principles call on our essential selves and our expansive core to live more freely. If you're free to be in unity, you're really free to live from that essential place inside yourself, not just to understand it. We embody unity when we know, as part of our being, that we are connected. We're connected to each other, and we're connected to this world. In the South African Click language, which I cannot speak, so I'm only going to say it to you phonetically, the South African Click language, Isiosha, there's a saying, Umuntu, Numuntu, Nabantu, which means a person is a person through other people, and expresses the belief in the ultimate connectedness of all people. Again, Dan Siegel, self does not equal me, self equals we. And Ron Kurtz, that knowing is the healing power of this work. Unity expresses our ability to make a relationship with the mystery of life in another person from the mystery of life in ourselves. Our ability to connect with our clients depends on our shared humanity. And for this, our own vulnerability is key. My latest source of inner light is David White, W-H-Y-T-E, the highly inspirational and internationally acclaimed poet, author, and lecturer. In his own words, no real conversation happens without vulnerability. Vulnerability is the invitation to self to show up. And again, David White, to be human is to become visible while carrying what is hidden as a gift to others. To be human is to become visible while carrying what is hidden as a gift to others. In practice, the principle of unity guides the relationship between therapists and clients toward equality, and in doing so calls for a non-hierarchical relationship. While the focus of a session is clearly on the client, when we stand apart in the name of professionalism, we lose some of the vital connection necessary to do this kind of work. Deirdre Fay, our local esteemed colleague and personal friend, once said, "You have to love your client. Love your client to find ways to see the best in them." David White, if you're sincere about your work, it will break your heart. Your work will completely break your heart into loving. The principle of organicity. The principle of organicity asserts our respect for life and our faith in the healing power of the individual. Organicity is the belief that inherent in the psyche is a natural drive toward health and healing. Psychotherapy is healing, and healing only happens to living organisms. You can fix a car or a bookcase, you can repair a TV or a computer, but you don't heal them, and they don't heal themselves. Only living systems heal, and they don't get fixed or repaired. Healing is an act of self-recreation. One cannot heal another. One can only help or hinder. Ron Kurtz, the client is an experience waiting to happen rather than a problem waiting to be solved. Given an environment that is safe, compassionate, and attentive, the human psyche will naturally tend toward health. This means that by providing safety and attending to present moment experience, a process of healing will unfold spontaneously. Thus, the therapist can rely on and be guided by an internal process of unfolding. In the words of Albert Schweitzer, within every patient there resides a doctor, and we as physicians are at our best when we put our patients in touch with the doctor inside of themselves. The spiritual tradition that speaks most clearly to the principle of organicity is Taoism, which advocates a life of non-interference with the course of natural events. We embody the organicity principle when we look for and follow natural processes. We do not impose a structure. We do not impose an agenda. When we embody the principle of organicity, we follow and support our client's own pace and process. And in turn, we create a situation where those experiences that need and want to happen can happen. According to Ron Kurtz, therapy cannot proceed without it. The path toward healing, however, is not linear. It may be, in fact, circuitous. Again, Ron Kurtz, in childhood, we learn a self. As adults, we use that self. We maintain that self through habit. The self we created long ago may be forgotten. But within us, there's still that possibility of self-creation. The self that was once fresh and flexible exists simultaneously with the self maintained through habit. And this phenomenon David White calls the beautiful centrality of opposites. To embody the organicity principle is to trust that by staying with the process as it is unfolding, new options will become available. 1 minute. The principle of nonviolence. Nonviolence is a central tenet in Buddhism, born of an attitude of acceptance and active attention to the ways in which events unfold. In Taoism, there's the principle of mutual arising. If you use force against a living system, you'll get resistance. In therapy, it means if you use force, you will get resistance. Violence in therapy is not just deliberate. Violence in therapy can be subtle. In terms of the nonviolence principle in sensorimotor psychotherapy, when we assume we know what is best for another, we have violence. If we rely on interpreting or naming, he's a narcissist, she's a borderline, we cut off the possibility of knowing what is within another person. If we stay in the names we made for this person, that's where a relationship ends. In the spirit of attempting to organize complexity, we tend to assign each and everything a name in an effort to organize, perhaps to understand, maybe even to control it. However, try as we might, it's not possible to name and organize the elusive thing called the self. Rather than naming or explaining, rather than formulating a cohesive narrative, rather than engaging a client in conversation or simply talking about or even reporting an event that happened in the past, help your client to reach key experiences they've not had before by eliciting present moment experience. In this way, we help our clients reach key experiences that allow him or her to know what is possible. And this next sentence is a combination of mine and David White's. For therapy is the art of triggering deep memories of what it means to be fully human. I can cry with that one. Embodying nonviolence is not only how we speak to our clients. Embodying nonviolence is how we speak to ourselves. David White, if we spoke to others the way we speak to ourselves, we'd never have another friend. Make the internal conversation more invitational. Body-mind holism. My favorite way of explaining sensorimotor psychotherapy is to say everyone has three stories to tell. The story of the words, or the narrative. The story, the expression of the feelings, or the emotions. And the body has its own story to tell. And in sensorimotor psychotherapy, we make room for all three stories. Rumi, there's a voice that doesn't use words. Listen. In sensorimotor psychotherapy, we invite the body to join the conversation. While the body is a rich realm of psychological material, much of the field of psychotherapy has concentrated on events that occur in the mind. Memories, associations, internal object representations, problem-saturated narratives, and pathogenic beliefs. Despite the fact that many psychological events actually occur non-verbally or in a pre-verbal state, and can be accessed best, or perhaps only, through the body. We can think of this as playing out a psychological drama somatically, not just talking about it. For example, characterological tendencies are always embodied. Psychic structures are clearly represented in the body. Defenses are also somatically represented. Crossing of the arms, slouching, puffing the chest. As expressed in the wisdom of Charlie Brown, this is my depressed stance. When you're depressed, it makes a difference how you stand. The worst thing you can do is straighten up and hold your head high, because then you'll start to feel better. If you're going to get any enjoyment out of being depressed, you've got to stand like this. Pat Ogden, a pioneer in somatic therapy, is the founder and director of the Sensorimotor Psychotherapy Institute. Look for Pat's chapter in the book we're celebrating today. According to Pat Ogden, a paradigm shift is called for, a paradigm shift that privileges mindful awareness of the moment-to-moment experience of implicit patterns. Implicit patterns of words, implicit patterning of emotions, and the body's own implicit patterns, over engaging in conversation, talking about, or simply talking about an event that has happened in the past. The principle of mindfulness. Oh, thank you. Thank you. There. As J.P. Morgan once said, all else being equal, I prefer a man who tastes his food before he salts it. Mindfulness begins with a preference for tasting over doing, a preference for taking the time to simply study experience before doing anything about it. And mindfulness is not just for our clients. To embody mindfulness requires us, as therapists, to be able to communicate with our clients in various states of consciousness. And this is achieved only by being close to mindfulness ourselves, and to convey that through our own shifts in pace, in prosody, in the patterns of speech, and in the kinds of words we choose. You'll like this one, John. In the words of John Kabat-Zinn, mindfulness is relationality. By analogy, think of receiving and sending messages back and forth. I know you are receiving me, and I know I am receiving you. This is important now. Mindfulness in sensory motor psychotherapy is not an isolated activity. Mindfulness in sensory motor psychotherapy is a joint venture and firmly embedded in what occurs between ourself and our client, moment to moment. Pat Ogden calls this embedded relational mindfulness. As such, mindfulness is not only a basic therapeutic technique in sensory motor psychotherapy, but it's also a significant part of the stance of the therapist. In addition to attending to our clients' narratives, and don't get me wrong, we do also attend to our clients' narratives in sensory motor, we embody embedded relational mindfulness. When we embody embedded relational mindfulness, we attend to the second-by-second fluctuation of our clients' thoughts, feelings, sensations, and movements in the course of the therapy hour. In the words of Pat Ogden, it's as if our clients take us with them into their inner world as their experience unfolds. In sensory motor psychotherapy, mindfulness is employed in a very specific way, termed directed mindfulness. When we use directed mindfulness, rather than allow our clients' attention to randomly shift to whatever catches their interest, we direct their mindful attention to specific elements of internal experience, thoughts, feelings, sensations, and movements. As sensory motor psychotherapists, we embody the attitude of embedded relational mindfulness when we simultaneously direct our mindful attention to our own internal experience as well. As the stealth emergence of our own histories, if not attended to, can eclipse our relational connection with our client and thus impede therapeutic progress. In closing, sensory motor psychotherapy, as informed by the implicitly contemplative foundational principles with its embedded relational mindfulness techniques and use of directed mindfulness, provides both a map and tools for healing trauma. Thank you.
How's everybody doing? Alive and well? Take a deep breath. Good. Well, next up, I'm delighted to introduce to you Frank Anderson, psychiatrist and current president of the Foundation for Self-Leadership, as well as a lecturer and supervisor with the Trauma Center at the Justice Resource Institute here in Boston. So if you'd welcome Frank.
Well, I'm really thrilled to be here. I'm honored to be here, and I'm honored to be amongst these folks and to learn from everybody. Today I'll be speaking about internal family systems. Just curious, how many people in the room even know what IFS is or internal family systems? Okay, great. Wonderful. Okay. Yeah, that's right. We're in Boston. That's exactly right. Okay, well, hold on one second. Okay, so John this morning was saying he doesn't like to diagnose people, or he's not that into diagnoses. I wasn't quite sure what you're you're saying about that. Not what you're talking about. I'm also agreeing with that, but I'm going to give you all a diagnosis. Okay, we all have multiple personalities. Okay, this is one of the main tenets and beliefs of IFS. Okay, we all have parts. We don't have multiple personality disorders, But we all have multiple personalities, okay? It's one of the main things that I'll be talking about today is some of the differences. I loved hearing the other talks here because there's so much commonality in EMDR and in sensory motor psychotherapy and in IFS around healing trauma, okay? These are treatments. These are not spiritual practices, okay? These are treatments for healing trauma. There is a lot of hope, and there is a lot that can be done to permanently heal trauma. And it's great to have. I mean, in my opinion, you can't be a trauma therapist this day and age if you don't incorporate and do these kinds of treatments. Because this is non-talking therapy. This is emotionally implicit memory-based healing. And that's what's necessary for trauma. Okay? So I'm going to focus on IFS. And as I said, it's a model of psychotherapy. It's not a spiritual practice. However, it does include systems thinking. The goal of trauma treatment from the IFS perspective is systems integration. We're all systems, okay? As I said before, we all have multiple personalities. And it does include spiritual traditions, okay? Self-energy is a very spiritual experience, which I'll talk a little bit later about. IFS also includes mindfulness and utilizes mindfulness. So it utilizes a lot of these tools in the service of healing. The goals of IFS therapy, pretty basic, but they're basic, but they're important. It is a healing model, and it is to unburden the wounds that we carry, number one. Number two, it's restoring the trust in the self, self-energy, that has been lost as a result of the trauma and as a result of burdens and wounds, and it's the reharmonization of the system, okay? So this idea of self, and I teach neuroscience also, and there's all this cortical midline structure stuff going on around what is self, where is self, what's self-representation in the brain, okay? This is not what I'm talking about here, and I'm not talking about the unitary self either. It's one of the things that I love about IFS is this self is an experiential thing. Okay, I was talking to Jim earlier at lunch today, and what is self? It's certainly not located in anywhere in the brain in the way that I experience it. I think about it as kind of a maximally integrative experience. It allows us to be interconnected. It allows us to connect with energy amongst ourselves, amongst the universe, the trees, the animals, and within. And it's something, it took me in level one, level two, level three training. It took me midway through level two training to feel what self felt like for the first time. And I actually feel this vibrating energy going through my body, and that's when I know I'm in self, okay? And it's a place of openness and the place of no judgment to be able to be fully present for who you're with, or what you're with, I should say. Okay, one of the differences in some of the contemplative practices, from the IFS perspective, self does not need to be practiced or cultivated. It is inherently in all of us. We are born with it. It is not destroyed, but trauma blocks access to it. So it's a simple concept to remove the burdens and the blocks to allow self to naturally emerge. I can't tell you how many clients I've worked with who have DID who are convinced there is no self in there. And I just clearly agree to disagree because I know it is inherently present in all of us. And it doesn't need to be created, okay? Some people call it the core seat of consciousness. Some people call it spiritual. It's an interconnectedness, in my experience, with all things. And it's a really great place to be. I think John was saying, it's not hard to go to work, okay? Not when you're in that experience, because it's beautiful. Here's some of the words. Every model has their jingles. It's calm, curious, compassionate, creative, clarity. Some of the words we talk about to describe self-energy. This is some of where, and this is some of what comes in the chapter in the IFS, in the book that was, that we're celebrating today, actually. It talks about some of this overlap and similarity around Buddha nature, loving kindness, compassion, equanimity, sympathetic joy, Tibetan Buddhism around everything within enlightenment. So this is a similarity, I think, that we can call the self energy in IFS to Buddhist practice. So a little bit about the model. We all have parts. We all have multiple personalities. We're born with them too, okay? We're not just born with self. We believe you're also born with parts. And when, you know, the system's new, it's all working smoothly together. And it's only through our experiences in life that burdens develop, okay? Now, I could take this to the next level. Personally, I believe we can come into this world with burdens that are related to past lives, but we're not going to go there here in this talk because I have 6 minutes left, whatever it is. So this is for another time, believe me. So for these purposes, we come in, okay, with self and with parts that are fully integrated. IFS believes all parts are welcome. The suicidal parts, the cutting parts, all welcome. Really believe it. IFS does not really believe in the stages of trauma treatment. Okay, I'm writing a chapter right now in a book around the ways IFS is different from stage-oriented treatment. When somebody comes in with a big slash, we say, wow, that's so great that that part showed up. Thank you for being here. I know you're doing something important to this system. I want to learn about it. Thank you for showing up. Okay, and that, in our belief, is the way to get to the underlying wound. Those are protective parts that are protecting in the ways that they know how to protect this system because they were born at the time of a burden or a trauma. All parts are welcome, and we really believe that. Therapists have them too, by the way. Some people call this countertransference. We call it parts. And our parts, anytime I do a consultation, it's about the parts of the therapist that are getting in the way of the work of the client, okay? We show all parts compassion, appreciation, and the important role and the function that they do within the system. As I said, there are some parts that, we have two categories of parts, parts that serve a protective role and parts that carry wounds or burdens, okay? These parts that carry protective roles can come in two forms, an extreme protective. Once a trigger has happened, I will do everything in my power to stop it. Okay, so some parts stop the triggering no matter what. Those are our extreme parts. And we have other really hardworking parts that try to prevent things from happening. If I'm really good, if I'm really smart, if I'm really funny, they're going to like me and I'm not going to get hurt. Hard-working parts to prevent, okay? We also have parts that hold wounds and burdens, okay? Parts are not their burdens. We're not interested in getting rid of them or pushing them away. We want to embrace them and we want to have self develop a relationship with this part that's serving a really important role. There's steps in the model, just like every other model has their steps. And we utilize meditation here, okay? Mindfulness meditation to start to find the part, go inside, focus your attention on the part, ask one of these questions, how do you feel toward the part? That's, is there any self-energy around? I hate this part. It destroys my life. That's not one of those C words. Okay? I'm curious about it. I want to get to know it. Then we know that self is present in relationship to the part. We want to hear about it. We want to befriend the part. One of the main things of mindfulness that we utilize in IFS around working with parts is creating that separation or what we call unblending. So so that the person is no longer in the part. Somebody earlier said, love when anger shows up. It's scary to be with somebody when they're in anger, unless they're able to be with their anger. A part of me is so mad right now, is very different than I want to kill you, okay? So this idea of separation is enormously important in our capacity for the client to be with these hugely powerful affects and for the therapist to be. So we work on that separation so that people can be with these extreme beliefs and feelings, okay? One of the other things, it's one of these little tricks, it's gonna be a secret, like as if you guys, I'm gonna only tell you, but I'll make it that way for dramatic effect. This is a crazy thing if you ask the part to not overwhelm you. They do. This is one of the ways IFS can be with extreme affects, okay, and not get overwhelmed. If you get permission and you get a full agreement that the part is willing to not overwhelm you, it doesn't. It's a crazy thing. This is one of Dick Schwartz's laws of inner physics. Like, how did this happen? I don't know. I just asked and they did it. And that works. So it's one of the ways to be with that, okay? How much time do I have next, Dave?
3 minutes.
3 minutes. Perfect. Okay. I love when it works out that way. Okay. So lastly, I want to speak about healing, okay? Because we are talking about permanent healing, okay? This is something that's real. This is something that anybody who's experienced it feels it and knows it, okay? And I believe, and Dick Schwartz is not here right now, okay, that IFS is not the only form of therapy that can do this, okay? This is being videotaped, oh my God. Now, IFS does it well. I think other modalities can do this permanent healing, okay? We call it unburdening, and this is a model of transformation instead of adaptation, okay? We are transforming memory. Okay, permanently. transformation happens, the unburdening process. Are folks familiar with memory reconciliation? Bruce Ecker's work. I really believe that there's a lot of similarity between the unburdening process and IFS and memory reconciliation. There's a witnessing phase, okay? You access the traumatic effects without having it overwhelm you, okay? We witness it. Self is there to witness all the pain. Anything else? Is anything else I need to know? What else do I need to know? When all the witnessing has occurred, with self being present, then we go into the scene. Memory reconsolidation works imaginally as well. We know this. This has been studied. We go and get the part out of the scene. You no longer have to be there. You never have to go back to that place again. This is a promise. Once the part is out of the scene, once it's shared everything, it's not the only holder of the information. So it can leave that space. We bring it somewhere safe in the present, and then we invite it to unload all the memories, thoughts, and feelings out of its body. Throw it in the river, burn it in a fire, whatever works for the system is fine. But they can unload all those feelings and beliefs. And then we ask it to bring in new qualities that it needs to move forward in life. Last piece in this process is to have any of the parts that have been protecting to come back and take a look and see what's happening in this system now. And most of the time what happens is the part's like, wow, I don't have to do this job anymore. And then the protective parts are also free to do something else. It's a powerful model. It's spreading around the country because it works and people experience it. And again, it's one of the ways to permanently heal trauma. Thank you for listening, and I hope you guys enjoy the rest of the day.